Just another, just a couple more practical things. You know, we've talked about forecasting your votes. You don't want to do that. You don't want to forecast or suggest to citizens that there have been basically votes or decisions made that they've not been privy to, particularly this body. This body right here, you know, you are the entity that has the public hearings for zonings. And you don't need, for instance, even in these work sessions to get in here and forecast your decision-making, because there are procedural protocols that are supposed to occur, like the public hearing, that you need to hear before you make your decision. The whole point of the public hearing is so that you have the input of these citizens as part of your decision-making process. I know you're not making a decision from the standpoint of ruling on the zoning, but you are making a recommendation, and the recommendation has legal significance. And I think that we do ourselves a disservice around this table if you don't recognize how important that is. And certainly there's been many a zoning case where consistency with the Planning Commission recommendation has been important. So you want to make sure that all of your deliberations and discussions are occurring in an open session.
Can I ask you one other thing? Just happened to come to mind. It's probably out of sync, but going back to the posting of the notice and stuff.
Yes.
I know in the building here, the notices are posted kind of around the corner in the little cubby hole back there. Is that the best place that we should have it posted, or should we have it posted out here in the vestibule? Or in the, you know, because a citizen, when they walk in, they almost have to know where to go to find it. You know, where is it? That's just a question.
Well, again, it may just be subject to space and where it makes sense to have it. I mean, if you go to the courthouse, to get to the public notices in the courthouse, you've got to go through security. I did that this morning, and that's not terribly conducive to the public going in either, because I'm going to avoid that place like the plague, because I'd take my belt off to get in there. Mm-hmm. But the answer is I am comfortable that is conspicuous notice under the Act. I mean, it's posted freely in the publicly available lobby that you can simply walk in. Could it be better? Yeah, it can always be better. It could be put on a LED screen out in front of the. You see what I'm saying? Yes, it could be. It could be better, but I am comfortable that is conspicuous notice under the.
Sorry to back you up there.
No. That's a perfectly legitimate question.
Let me ask you this: if one commissioner were to ever call another commissioner, and you're talking about a matter,
yes.
When you don't have a quorum,
yeah.
Would that be in conflict as well?
That's a good question. Just to make sure I repeat it so I'm comfortable with it, one commissioner, planning commissioner, board commissioner, or any other body that's subject to the Act calls another one to discuss the affairs that are in front of it. No, that's not a violation of the Act. Okay. Two commissioners, be it planning commission members or board of commission members, can speak. I mean, the rule is very clear. Now, I will make an exception to this, but it's an exception that I think won't catch anybody by surprise. What the Open Meetings Act provides is that a quorum of the governing authority, or you, quorum of this body as well, can comprise a meeting under the Act. But it also provides that if there has been an agency-created subcommittee, that is agency created, a quorum of that committee can also comprise an Open Meetings Act violation if they meet improperly. So what I have seen in the past is, for instance, the Board of Commissioners or in other jurisdictions I work in have, let's say they have a finance committee, that two members of the Board of Commissioners are appointed to the finance committee, and they're supposed to go out and hear things about the finances of the county and bond transactions and the millage rate. And they're officially board-sanctioned, authorized committee. That's just two of them. But I think under the Open Meetings Act, that would be a quorum. So you don't have to worry about that, because I don't know of the Planning Commission creating these sub-entities of itself. So from your perspective, count to three. Okay, count to three. Two of you is not going to be a problem. The only last caveat to that, and just something to be mindful of, and I say this because I know that it is an issue, and I'm not going to necessarily go down the path of what my opinion is on it right now, but if there is an intention to avoid the Act, understand this, an intention to avoid the Act, by dividing up into subgroups specifically to avoid the act. I know that downtown, the Attorney General, I believe, frowns on that practice. Two by two by one. Everybody understand what I'm getting to? Here, the same subject matter, but divide up specifically not to comply. Attorney General, I think, takes a dim view of that. Yes, sir.
Okay. How about two of us meeting with one commission, one board of commissioners? Is that? Or you could do two of us could meet with two commissioners, but two of us couldn't meet with three. You know, so two of them. Okay.
That's right.
So we're totally separate. From
yeah. This commission I'm particularly comfortable with, too, is fine. Mm-hmm. Particularly comfortable. Any other questions? Again, I don't want to spend all the time on the Open Meetings Act. I'll only say this: once you know, the Open Meetings Act was put into law to build confidence in government. And I'll say this sort of in an overreaching, broad way: everything an appointed or an elected agency should do should follow the same guidelines of trying to have and to foster confidence in government. And that means, and I'll say it this way: with my children, I set these rules, right? And here's the line, and if you step across the line, you're going to get in trouble by me. My kids seem to want to skirt up right next to the line and get right next to it, and that's where they want to live their lives, is right there. And I would only suggest to you that on government, my respectful recommendation is we probably shouldn't get near the line, because I think ultimately our citizens deserve that we're not even trying to straddle the line between correct and incorrect conduct. I'm talking about in our civic life, of course. You know, the way we conduct the operations of the government, we got to stay well clear of the line.
You're talking about legal as well as ethical?
Absolutely. Legal is, and I think they're almost synonymous. Legal and ethical are almost synonymous. But yeah, that's my point, and that's why I try to teach people, let's just err well clear of the line, and you'll be fine.